A few years ago, I was watching the movie Steve Jobs. In the movie, there is a discussion between Steve Wozniak and Steve Jobs.
Woz?
Yeah?
On your wrist.
You want to know?
I literally can't wait.
Everyone's going to be wearing these in 10 years. It's a Nixie watch made using Nixie tubes. This is actually 40-year-old technology. Cold cathode tubes. They're operating at 140 volts. I tilt my wrist 45 degrees. It's right there. Hours, minutes, and seconds. The way our minds work. Look at that.
In the particular scene, Steve Wozniak is actually explaining about his Nixie watch to Steve Jobs. Ever since I saw that glow in the watch, I always wanted to do a similar watch for myself. When I started researching, I realized that the technology used was from the 1960s. It was pretty old technology, even before LEDs were prevalent. This tube had been used for display in clocks, calculators, aircrafts, spacecrafts, and more. Today, the market has different types of Nixie tubes. The prevalent ones are the 1960s models manufactured in Russia. For my clock project, I have imported 6 IN12A models of Nixie tubes from Ukraine. It says that these are new old stock, which means they are old but as good as new. We can assume they were not used much. Nixie stands for Numerical Indicator Experimental Displays and was primarily used for display operations in the 1960s. Normally, these display operations were performed using the vacuum tube technology through a process called thermionic emission, which involves a hot cathode. I've already spoken about that in my History of Electronics video, the link of which is also given above. You may revisit when you find time. But the technology around Nixie tubes is a little different. There is no vacuum inside this tube. Instead, they would fill the tube with a low pressure gas. Since there is no hot cathode, these tubes are commonly called as cold cathode tubes. If you see the tube, you could notice each number is made up of a metallic filament separated using ceramic plates. Since this was manufactured in the 1960s, it's difficult to get it now. But the Russians were using this extensively at that time, so these were manufactured in bulk and will be available until stocks last. The tube I have is IN12A. IN expands to indicator neon. Since these tubes have been filled with neon gas, when it glows, it lights up in orange color. If the same tube is filled with xenon gas, it lights up in blue, and krypton gas lights up in lavender. The orange color that emanates is actually a plasma that is the result of current passing through the neon gas. If you need to see the glow, you would need to input a voltage higher than the tube's striking voltage, which is usually around 100 volts DC. If we apply a DC voltage of more than 100 volts between the anode and the cathode, the electrons separate from the neon atoms and the separated neon atom becomes a positively charged ion. This process is called ionization. Now, the negatively charged electrons travels towards the positively charged anode and the positively charged ions would travel towards the cathode mesh with the numbers. In the process of the charges moving back and forth, there is a current flow inside the tube. When the positively charged ions travels towards the cathode, there are chances that it could collide with another neon atom. The rest of the ions would continuously be hitting the cathode mesh and the collision would eject the atoms in the filament. This process is called in technical terms as sputtering. The ejected metal atoms collide with the generated electrons, losing energy in the process and converting it to photons, which are the light that we could see. But we cannot make a wristwatch using these tubes. Let's start by making a clock and then come to the wristwatch. Let's now list the components required to make the clock. A 12 volt DC adapter as power supply input. A high voltage boost converter module to boost the 12 volt DC to 170 volt DC. An Arduino nano board to control the Nixie tube drivers. A high voltage driver circuit components. Rotary encoder to set the time. 6 units of IN12A Nixie tubes to display the hours, minutes and seconds. 4 INS1 neon indicators for the coordinate indicator. A real-time clock module to maintain the time accurately. And some miscellaneous discrete electronic components. Alright, let's now prepare a circuit to interface the microcontroller, driver circuits and the Nixie tubes. The detailed information about the circuit will be available on my Instructables page, so don't forget to check it out. Now we need to design a PCB board to arrange the Nixie tubes and interface the microcontroller with the driver circuit. I'm going to use the Eagle software from Autodesk for this purpose. Alright, our PCB design is now ready. The PCB board will be fit into a wooden enclosure. I'm going to create the enclosure using the Fusion 360 software with the right dimensions and import the PCB design into the Fusion 360 to check if it fits perfectly inside the enclosure. I think it fits well as per the design. We can get the PCB boards manufactured. I have sent the gerber files to a company called PCB Power to manufacture the PCB board. This is a two-layer board. We will now use this to assemble our components. We will not solder the Nixie tubes directly into the PCB board. That could damage the Nixie tubes sometimes and create hassles in removing them. To avoid damage, we would assemble the Nixie tubes as a plug-and-play connection. We will use separate socket pins for this purpose and solder the pins to the PCB board. Similarly, to use the IC as a plug-and-play type, we will solder the IC holders as well. Next, we will solder the SMD capacitors and resistors. Of late, many hobbyists fix the LED lights behind the tubes. That gives them more colorful and an immersive look. I'm also going to solder some green color LEDs behind the tubes. Let's check if the LEDs work. Cool, that works. This is the real-time clock module. You can see the DS3231 IC here. The timing operations will happen in this chip. We will input the power supply to the module and interface with Arduino through the I2C interface and set the time using the Arduino. We will request the time to the module and display the same in the Nixie tube. Even if we switch off the 12 volts power supply that goes to the Nixie clock, we have a 3 volt battery behind this module, which should be sufficient for the module to maintain time for years. We will set or adjust the time using the rotary encoder. This can also be used to switch off the LEDs if they are not needed or for any other features. Let's now attach the RTC module using a header to the PCB board. Next, let's fit all the Nixie tubes in the sockets. This is the high voltage boost converter module. An input voltage between 12 and 24 volts DC can be supplied to this board, and the output can be boosted from 85 to 235 volts DC. We will wire the screw terminals for the input and output. The trim port can be adjusted to set the output voltage. I am going to set the output voltage to 170 volts. We need 5 volts for our microcontroller logic. So let's use a step-down DC-DC converter module to get the 5 volt from the 12 volt DC input. Let's wire it together with the high voltage power supply to the screw terminals on the PCB. I already have the code ready, so let's power on and check if it works properly. Aha! Look at that! That's just perfect! This light glows almost after 40 years. It looks great. The LED lights below add to the splendor as well. I hope you are in as much awe as I am. The cold cathode tubes are amazing. Even though the digits are all separate, they are distinctly visible. The neon gas gets ionized inside and creates a plasma around the filament. I am going to use a small wooden box for the enclosure. Few holes need to be drilled on the box to fit the board inside. Let's mark the positions and drill them. The enclosure is now ready. Now we need a faceplate for this. To place the faceplate, we need screw wedges on the four sides. Let's 3D print the same and fit them. To keep the encoder knob and the DC jack, we will attach a small frame behind the box. Again, let's 3D print the same and fit them. it would be great to have bushes down the box. Let's print some bushes for this and fit them as well. First, let's attach the 12 volt DC input jack to the wooden frame. Next, let's attach and screw the encoder to the frame. Let's now fit the circuits inside and paste the additional iron bolts on the sides. Tighten all the screws. It's all assembled now. Let's check again if everything works well. That works! We'll now need to design the faceplate for the Nixie clock. We can design it using Fusion 360. We will cut the place where the Nixie tube needs to show. The rest of the areas would also need to be closed. Let's add our channel name as well. Since the enclosure is made out of wood, we will use a wood 3D printer filament to print the faceplate. Let's carefully place the faceplate inside the box and screw it tight. We'll also fit a holder behind the encoder. We can now use the rotary encoder to set the time. Isn't that cool? So that is all we have got for this week. The Nixie tube construction details, code, schematic, and all other technical details are shared in my Instructables page. So don't forget to check them out. Thanks for watching this video. See you again.